WERQ-FM, HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors or advertisers.
So pretty, his parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city.
Hello. We are back every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB. It's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Hello, Baltimore. Thank you for joining us during this second hour. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. Part of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you have the need to buy or sell your property or to purchase your ground rent or to update your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you are a listener who has a question or a comment, please text it to us at 667-334-7242 so we can include it in our conversation.
And attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning again, Baltimore. When I'm practicing law, my practice really is procurement. And so if you have contracts with the city, state, or federal government, or are seeking contracts or need assistance in qualifying for contracts, give me a call, 410-547-8820.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. That's 410-669-1738. We got a couple lines open. We have as our special guest today, and I certainly thank attorney Tehma Smith Wilson for contacting this distinguished gentleman, Joe Haskins, president of Harbor Bank. Here to answer some of your questions concerning the banking industry. And if you want to call in, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. He says he has a few more moments with us. We're going to go to Brother Carlos, and then we got a couple questions that have been sent to Tehma, and we're going to get into that. We got Gene on the air also. And we got three lines open if you want to call in, 410-481-1010. Let's go to Brother Carlos. Brother Carlos, you're on air.
Good afternoon to everybody. And I'll cut right to the chase to Brother Haskins. I'm sure that the black institutions would not be able to get away with this, but it is reported that the Silicon Valley Bank executives paid out huge bonuses and cashed in huge allotment of stocks to enrich themselves before the bank went belly up. Now, the same thing happened with Bear Stearns in New York several years ago. Is there any way that money can be clawed back that you know of? Do you have any insight onto that particular issue?
Carlos, that's a great question and an excellent point to raise or question to ask. There are technically five different investigations going on as we speak. The Federal Reserve Bank, because of their role in California, are looking at it. The FDIC, because of the insurance side, is looking at it. and the Treasury Department is looking at it. Now, those three regulatory entities are doing an investigation. Now, the other two that are looking at it gets at a little bit of where you are questioning and what will surface. And that is the Justice Department is looking at it from the criminal perspective, and the SEC, Security and Exchange Commission, is looking at it from that standpoint. In the corporate world, there are periods of times where you are allowed to sell your stock. And what management is attempting to say is that I took advantage of this period. However, what the Security and Exchange Commission will look at, as well as the Justice Department, is if their trade took place based on their insider knowledge. So if it's clear that they had insider knowledge and was cashing out ahead of time, that will be pursued from a legal perspective. The other side of it is the payment of bonuses. Normally in a contract, there are provisions that are set up which are known as clawback provisions, so that if it is determined that inappropriately these senior officers paid themselves bonuses, knowing that there was a problem in the bank or recognizing that there were going to be issues, there is a clause that allows those funds to be reclaimed back from the receivers.
Does that answer your question, okay, Brother Carlos?
Yeah, very, very well defined and answered. Thank you very much. Thank okay. you, sir.
Thank you, Brother Carlos. Mm-hmm.
Joe, do you know of any instances, putting aside Martha Stewart for the moment, are there any instances, I don't recall from 2007 that being any Justice Department criminal charges or prosecutions against anybody in the banking or securities industry, which clearly operated on the basis of insider information, because they were the ones making the decisions.
Yep. Yeah, there were none. And that's one of the reasons Biden is going off the chain now and saying, hey, okay, we're going to help you out, but somebody going to have to pay for some of this stuff.
Yeah. Well, good point. There are many who believe that there should have been some more strenuous penalties associated with the Great Recession, given what occurred. I will tell you that, without going into detail, I will tell you that many of the officers received penalties, and many of the board of directors received penalties, and several have been precluded from participating in the banking or financial industry. One name that people may recall and you see now was Michael Milken, and Bob, you might remember this.
Sure.
Michael Milken can have no activities directly in any financial institution. So there are heavier sanctions that have been assigned. And I can tell you that as a board member of a bank, there is a heavier responsibility, because if it's determined that you have operated in a self-serving way, or you have not been prudent in your decision-making as it relates to having provided access to loans or finances of the institution, you can be challenged. What you all may be reading now or seeing at the moment is that the CEO of the largest bank, J.P. Morgan, is being asked to testify about why his bank allowed the gentleman Jeffrey, who was providing special benefits and treats to officers and who had a problem. I can't think of his last name at the moment. But we do get called down, and oftentimes, while there's not a prison sentence, it doesn't mean that there aren't other sanctions that have been levied, especially financial penalties, clawbacks of bonuses and or challenges with reference to stock insider trading.
Okay, we got a couple questions from Tehma that's been texted in. Then we're coming back to the phone lines with Gene and Ray, and we have some lines open, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Go ahead, Tehma.
I have two questions. One is a personal question, and the other one is kind of a transitioning question. The first question is, do you have a succession plan, and where do you see Harbor Bank 10 to 15 years from now?
Yes, I do. In fact, we'll be making an announcement shortly on that. As you know, I'm one of the founders, and even if I were a child prodigy, I would still be up in age. And so one of the critical decisions for many of our businesses, as one of your earlier callers referenced, one of your callers talked about how do you ensure success with African-American businesses and make sure that they can continue. And that gets to succession planning. So we have a succession plan. It's being finalized as we speak, and not to put myself on the spot, but to say I'll be happy to come back and talk about that. And something will be coming out in the very near future with reference to that.
And then the second question is, the FDIC insurance coverage has been $250,000 for a number of years. Do you think the FDIC will increase that dollar value due to inflation? And after you answer that question, can you talk to us a little bit about inflation and how increasing interest rates, you know, assist with inflation?
Good. Well, you have two good ones there. First, I will tell you that there is discussions that are taking place in Washington at the moment about whether or not to increase the 250 coverage. Numbers have been discussed as high as $500,000. That's going to get a lot of discussion. Some have actually said that the system should be designed in a way that every depositor is covered. I don't think that's going to happen. I think there could be some increase, but it's going to take quite a bit of discussions. By the way, all banks are required to pay into the FDIC fund. So these first dollars that went into supporting SVB and Signature actually came out of the FDIC fund. It may end up costing the fund about $20 billion. The way that they will make it up is that we will get an additional fee assessed against us. So many of us will take a hard look at agreeing to support whether or not the amount of coverage is increased or not, because it would automatically mean an increase in the fees that the bankers pay. So that's to your first question. Your second question, again, is a spot on. One of the reasons that the Fed increased interest rates is to help address the inflation matter. The question is, how does that impact? Well, when you start increasing interest rates, you cut down the purchasing power of the individual. So if you're sitting with a fat bank account and money in your pocket, you're much more inclined to purchase something that you wouldn't normally purchase, and it can fall into the luxury good items, you don't complain as much about the cost of something raising because you have the resources to pay it. But when your income or your purse has been lessened, then you think more about whether or not you want to pay a couple extra dollars for a dozen eggs or for whatever item it is that you decide that you want. So raising interest rates help to address it because it reduces the amount. In fact, you'll see with loans, for example, we had interest rates on loans, and loans were available for businesses to borrow as low as 2 and 3%. Well, now we have a prime rate that's up at 8%, but many borrowers are not borrowing at that. They're borrowing at 10%. So if you look at it, you can see somebody who may have a 10% additional cost in the monies that they're borrowing. What? If we look at home mortgages, if we look back a couple of years ago, you could do a 30-year mortgage at slightly less than 3%. Well, now a 30-year mortgage is taking you up to 7%. So those who were in mortgages that were flexible or that had different adjustment rates tied to them, those individuals, without doing anything differently, probably moved from paying 3% on their mortgage up to 7% on their mortgages, which means that they have less household income and thereby have less buying power, which brings down inflation.
Joe, what problem is fixed by reducing the buying power of the consumer? What is inflation? Let me start with that. What is inflation?
Inflation is that if you were paying, and I'll use these, not that the exact numbers. Mm-hmm. If you were paying $3 for a dozen eggs, and now you're paying $5 for a dozen eggs.
Okay.
If you were paying $300 for your rent, and now you're paying $500 for your rent. If you were paying for your clothing, and this goes just across the board. So inflation is when the price of a product or service has been escalated based on what the market value will accept.
And unrelated to the cost of production. I mean, you could walk in the store and a carton of eggs one day is $3 a carton, and that same carton sitting there the next day, and it's gone up to $7. But the chickens didn't lay the eggs twice.
Yeah, that's the case. But if the demand is, I mean, and again, not to get into economics of supply and demand, you know, taking folks back. But so if you have lower supply and the demand is greater, people are going to pay more. And so what those who provide the products or services will do is that they will alter the supply so that the demand can be higher and thereby command a higher rate. And if folks have the resources to pay for those items, they create an inflation. So inflation really impacts the lower income population.
Right.
Because most of them are on fixed income or limited income. And so that individual isn't enjoying an annual escalation in salary or promotions, et cetera. And so they are now where they were paying $3 for their dozen eggs are forced to pay $5. So they've lost $2 worth of purchasing power. The question is, when you raised it properly, is that the eggs probably didn't cost any more to produce by the chicken or even the delivery. But but yet that person is being forced to pay more, which has put them in a more restricted purchasing power in carrying out their lifestyle.
Okay, we're going to Gene Ray. I think this is Kylie and Money Mikey. We got one line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Gene, you're on air.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Happy Friday.
Okay.
So, you know, it's wonderful having a great economics conversation, but isn't, you know, my last question will be, isn't the Fed trying to create a recession, you know, to offset the inflation? So, you know, that's my question, you know, in general and about economics, macro. So, but again, your short-term CD, you say it pays 3.4 something?
5.6.
5.6, okay. So, you know, I'm in a credit union. I get 1%. I'm shopping right now, and, you know, that's your return on the investment. So how long is that? Is that a 6 month or 1 year?
No, we did it for 2 years because interest rates may alter, and that's if you want to call my office, it's
410-528-1801.
They'll get you all the details. We have a whole series of different certificates that can be offered, but that's
Yes, sir. And I just asked that question so that the general listener can understand, you know, you're talking about 2 years, not 1 year, not 6 months. But again, you know, that's good. And that offsets, and you know, some of the inflation, you know, right? Mm-hmm. Correct. So, and then my other question is, if I have $500,000, I can only deposit $250 in your bank, or can I open up two accounts, $250 each, deposit it in?
You can if you open up one account, I can only cover you for $250. If you open up two accounts and you have the same Social Security number, it's going to get collapsed, and still limit you to the $250. But if it's done with another party and a different Social Security number, you can have both the 500 amount, the $250s coming together.
Okay, thank you very much. And if you have time, you know, if you could talk about recession, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay.
Thank you.
All right, let's go to Ray. You're on air. Ray?
Good morning.
Good morning. Go ahead, Ray. Ray, once. Ray, twice. Bye, Ray. I guess you have to call back. I believe this is Kylie. If it's not correct, please give me your name correctly. Is Kylie?
Yes, brother. This is Brother Kalik.
Oh, Kalik. Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay. My question was to the bank is how much planning, city planning? I'm about to beautify Baltimore, and how much are banks involved with city planning?
I can't speak to the other banks. I can only speak to Harbor. And what I will let you know is the Harbor Bank has been an instrumental part in helping to develop and help be a catalyst to any number of communities. For example, I actually helped set up EBDI, East Baltimore Development Inc. So if you look at the development there, we played a major role. We were the first lenders to EBDI. Through one of my other subsidiaries, I put tax credit money to develop that 855 Wolf Street where I have a branch. We helped develop 1812, which is a science building. We got Starbucks to put a roaster in there, so they're teaching African Americans over out of East Baltimore how to make coffee, which is unique in the state of Maryland. When we did that, the school that is there, Henderson Hopkins, we were a part of that development. I spoke earlier about our role in helping to bring about the development of Northwood Shopping Center through our investment, where we have a new technology branch there. If you look at Inner Harbor East, we were the first branch in Inner Harbor East, and we helped in the financing that led to the Marriott, that led to Spinnaker Bay. So we can go around the city to talk to you about the work that we did. One of my biggest joys is helping to convince the Archdiocese, Archbishop Lori, to do a Catholic school that's on Martin Luther King Boulevard. Our financing helped to make that happen. That's Mother Mary Lang School. So when we look around Baltimore, it's hard to find an area where we have not been a part of or touched. One of the callers earlier, I think it was, well, not callers, but one of the moderators here, Carlton, referred to the marches. Well, we were a part of helping in the financing of the march sensitivity center that's on North Avenue.
Roberta's House.
The Roberta's House. Yeah. We were in the financing of Roberta's House.
Right.
So again, we let our action sort of speak for us, and some have said we don't tell enough of our story, but our commitment to the revitalization and development of Baltimore is just sort of out there and somewhat legendary to some extent.
Yeah, I have always loved the concept of Harbor Bank when it first came into existence. But then, alluding to your last sentence, I kind of lost track of what you were doing. I said, well, how is Harbor Bank impacting my community? Are they helping to develop minority contractors by, you know, through development? Or what the heck are they doing? I hear about these other banks, the major, you know, the white banks, but black banks have just virtually gone off the map. So that's what I'm concerned with. And especially we have a family, the Mitchell family, that the courthouses that everybody knows about that are named for. But the corridor on Druid Park Drive, where those dilapidated houses are, that kind of development, I know money has come into the city to develop housing. Could you speak to that?
Yes, I will tell you, prior to the Great Recession of 2007-2008, we financed about 100 different development projects in that Reservoir Hill area. Unfortunately, the Great Recession put a lot of that on hold or delayed. And so the banking system in general was going through a bit of a crisis. And one of the other, I guess, callers or someone spoke to recessions. Harbor, by the way, we've lived through four recessions. One of them, again, 2007, 2008, the Great Recession. So what we've learned how to do is to profit when profits are there, but when they're not, sometimes we have to pull back. And if you think back about it, many of the banks that existed before 2007 do not exist today, but Harbor is still here. Some of what I decided to do, because banks were getting so much criticism, is to take us slightly below the radar so that people wouldn't be focusing on us, because we were still operating and surviving. And so that was some of my decision. We are going to pick up on our development and the work that Harbor is doing in the coming years. And I think Tehma was commenting about, you know, planning for the future and the succession planning. And that's one of the aspects that we will be looking at, is telling a little bit more of the story so that it's clear. And as I mentioned earlier, we are actually educating those to help further do development in the city. And we know that those that have gone through our training program, which we certify, they have done thousands of renovations and housing throughout the city. Again, we don't talk about it, but our work and our actions are out there to be seen. But we will pick up on that as we look more toward the future.
Okay, this is going to be the last caller on this subject, because we got about half an hour left, well, really 27 minutes, and we got some other things we want to get to. Money Mike, you the last man on the totem pole.
Thank you, Carlton. The president of the bank, what's your name again?
Joe Haskins.
Joe Haskins. Mr. Haskins, first let me answer the recession issue. Inflation happens because there's too many dollars chasing too few goods. That's it in a nutshell. If you have too much money supply in the system, It causes inflation to happen because people who are opportunists, and maybe it's just good business, tend to raise the prices. So therefore, we have to have a recession. Also, we have wage inflation, which we have now. That's the big problem with inflation. Corporations and companies have to pay wages. Because there's a shortage of workers, for various reasons, I won't go into them all, but wages have gone up. So this government typically likes to have unemployment at 4%, 2% really, but that's unemployment is just too low. Too many people are needed in the working populace who are not seeking work. I don't know if it's because of COVID, because of their age, because of free money, but they're not working. Also, the money supply. We funded wars that we haven't paid for. We lowered the tax rate on wealthy income workers. And so that causes inflation. So that's what it is. And the other thing I wanted to talk to you about is
Hold it, Money Mike. Do you have a question for Joe Haskins?
Yes. Okay, Mr. Haskins, I'd like to meet with you. I came to you a couple years ago, and I had $100,000 to put into your bank. For whatever reason, nobody wanted to make an appointment with you. So I'm asking you now. My name is Money Mike. I'd like to put $100,000 in your bank because I have too much money in other banks. So I thought it'd be nice to meet you and find out what's going on, but you let me know if I can make it happen.
Money Mike, we can make it happen. By the way, my title at the moment is Chairman and CEO. I have a President, John Lewis, that I want you to meet so that you can know some of what is in the future. And as I gave a little teaser, I want to come back to, as I've been offered an opportunity to talk about the future and introduce my succession plan so that the community will know who to talk to, who to reach. But I will, as a founder and the current chair, I will be watchful of what we do and remain committed to bringing banking, financial services, and resources to this community.
Joe, give him your number so he can contact you so you can get this appointment set up.
410-528-1882.
410-528-1882. You got it, Money?
Money Mike.
I got it, Carl.
Okay.
Good.
Well,
give us a call. Thank you.
Mr. Haskins, we certainly want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come on to Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, attorney Robert Bob, the Dean, the Shields, and myself, Carlton Douglas. You can, anytime you're ready to come back and make that announcement, just get in touch with Tehma and let her know you want to come on, and we'll be open. And I would say to those out there that have your money in other banks and for whatever reason may not have ever dealt with Harbor, give them a chance. First of all, I want to tell you, Joe, kudos to my girl Cheryl down on Fed Street. Because she takes good care of our money at the Arena Players, and she looks out for me in my account today. I think she does an excellent job, and whenever I call, she makes sure she gets right back to me and get right on whatever situation I might have there. So I want to give kudos out to her today.
Well, if you're going to say that, I got to mention Rita Wingate at the Randallstown branch.
All right. All right.
Where she's been almost as long, I think, as I've been a customer there. That's a very good crew, Rita and my buddy Sam, who's been there since I think Dirk was born.
And as well, I would like to give a shout out to the two Robins at the Wolf Street branch.
I'm sure
they'll be hearing from my mother because that 3.5 interest rate. She chases CDs, and usually when you
it's up to 5.6 now.
Usually when you have rates there, the top in the country for CDs, so you will be hearing from her.
Yeah, Joe, we certainly thank you And our listener audience is open to you anytime you want to come on and discuss whatever you want.
Frank, thanks so much for the opportunity. Tehma, thanks for reaching out to me. Bob Dashiell, I've known for I don't know how many years, and Carlton, you guys. I mean, I'm delighted that I was extended the opportunity, and just know Harbor's here for you, and thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Appreciate you. Thank you, Tehma, again, for getting Joe Haskins on.
Thank you.
We got another special guest on the air, and then I got something I want you guys to hear. We got on the air the president of the Baltimore City chapter of the NAACP, my friend and colleague. I believe this is Brother Kobe Little.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
How are you, Kobe?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well. Thanks be to God.
I got a call.
How are y'all doing today?
All right. You're here with Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and of course, you know me. I got a call from Josh that you wanted to come on to address something today, so here's your chance.
Well, you know, we are grateful for the opportunity to come on the show. Just want to give a couple of updates. People may have heard now that our office was vandalized, attacked on Tuesday evening. We are physically okay, disappointed that this incident happened. And, you know, just want to send a message that, one, you know, if the idea was to deter us from our activism, then we're determined to press forward. If the idea was to somehow make us afraid, folks should know that we're encouraged. And if this was an act of mischief by young people, you know, we want to send a message that we want young people to join us in good trouble and to stay out of bad trouble. But also wanted to just give an update on two issues that we have been working on. One is inclusionary housing. We have written a letter of intent to file a complaint with HUD because of the city's failure to have an affirmatively furthering equity and inclusionary housing law. Also want to give an update on our negotiations or our conversations with the city as it relates to the BGE conduit contract. We are greatly concerned that there are no MBE goals in that contract. We are greatly concerned that the city pushed this contract through. And we're glad to report that the mayor has said that he's going to bring BGE to the table so that we can make sure that any deal that BGE does with the city is certainly advancing equity. Out of the BGE conduit deal conversations, one of the points that we've been raising is that going forward, the city should do no contract of $1 million or more without first doing an equity and diversity assessment to analyze how potential contract companies would do or have done in the past as it relates to their personnel practices, their black contracting practices, how they show up in the community. And then in addition to that diversity and equity assessment, we think all companies who have the privilege of doing business with the city ought to also issue a statement making commitment to equity investments. For over 200 years, corporations in Baltimore have benefited from inequity, and now it's their responsibility to help us deconstruct inequity and advance equity. So those are some of the major issues that we're working on at present.
Kobe, this is Bob DeShiel. Let me ask you a quick question. First of all, I'm glad you're doing well. But has the NAA considered taking legal action based upon the fact that the agreement entered into by the mayor, and you keep saying the city, but that was the only person that agreed to it was the mayor, they're taking legal action based upon the fact that the so-called agreement was in direct contravention, at least in my opinion,
of the will of the voters as expressed back in November, which would have which was intended to prohibit the transfer of this particular asset from city ownership to anybody, including BGE. Have you considered taking legal action from that perspective?
We certainly have been very deliberate in crafting a strategy to approach the multiple issues related to this. While this deal does not legally and permanently transfer control of the asset,
not true. It doesn't transfer title, but for all effective purposes, the other indicia of ownership are all now exclusively within the control of BGE. If you've read the agreement that I've read,
I was getting to that later.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm just trying to make the distinction for folks that the net impact is that BGE has control of the asset.
That's correct.
You know, but we've also considered legal action on a number of other issues, including the meeting that the contract was approved. But at the end of the day, we think that giving BGE and the administration the opportunity to come to the table and amend the deal is a more effective path.
But how are they going to do it, Kobe? Kobe, you opening it up.
I'm here.
You opening up a hypothetical situation. Are they going to come back to the table and do that?
What incentive do they have to do it?
Well, yeah.
They told us they were going to do that, and we want to operate in good faith. And, you know,
good
hopefully
luck
we'll
them,
have
Kobe.
A great and a...
Well, you know, Kobe, this acting city solicitor specifically requested the inclusion of the city's MBE program as a part of the agreement. And the mayor said no at the recommendation and request of BGE. So now you believe it when they say they're going to come back to the table and they're going to agree to do it voluntarily.
If you've been following anything that we've been doing, then you'll know that we're on it. Yesterday, I did an interview on another radio station, and I was asked, the point was made that Calvin Butler said that BGE does everything it can to support minority contractors and to advance diversity. And I point blank said, well, if that's the case, I don't know how David Ralph still has a job. David Ralph being the general counsel for BGE.
Yeah, but
I'm hopeful.
You know, the whole story is COVID. He's general counsel, but he was also the acting city solicitor when the BGE settlement was made of the litigation in 2018, and this deal was consummated with Jim Shea, was the city solicitor who was chairman emeritus of Venable, who happened to represent BGE when the settlement was done with David Ralph as city solicitor in 2018. And nobody wants to talk about it from that perspective. But yet, I got as many Brooklyn bridges as people want to buy.
For clarification, the BGE said they would come back to the table specifically to amend the contract, or did they just say they would come back to the table to have discussions about the contract?
About equity. That's the latter, my sister.
So they didn't say that they would amend the contract or change anything that they already signed. They just
It is our hope. It is our hope that is what will come out of these conversations. Mm. But again, we haven't had the conversation yet, so that's all I can say about it.
Okay, Kobe, on the break-in. Now I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, but there was a recording of these folk that attacked the building. Is that correct? Because I thought I saw it on TV. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. It seemed to me, now I may not have seen it very clearly, but it seemed to have been young people that did this. Are they recognizable enough for the justice authorities or the police to recognize who did this or not?
From my viewing of the video, I could not distinguish who these individuals were. But the Baltimore Police Department is conducting an investigation, and I will keep you updated as they update me.
Okay. All right. We thank you for coming on. We want to try to have you on a little more. I thought you were going to call in a little more often, letting us know what's going on. Because I'm still disgusted with the national office. Both the president, Derek Johnson, and the chairman of the board of the national office of the NAACP, especially how they handle the local election of Baltimore City branch as a debacle, in my opinion, of which I just found out that I was even elected back to the executive committee through Dashiell. I never even knew that I was elected back. And only 27 people voted, which was ridiculous. I certainly hope, and I know you're under pressure from the national office, but I certainly hope that somebody intervenes in this thing and try to let them know that, first of all, we need to go back to in-person meetings, both executive committee and the general body, and that they need to rectify themselves on before the next election.
Duly noted. Let me part by saying that the Baltimore NAACP is excited to be partnering with the Institute of the Black World for the State of the Black World Conference, which will be here April 19th through the 23rd. And you can go to IBW21.org for more information. This is going to be an exciting conference that addresses issues from reparations to community violence. We expect to have notable experts and people doing good work on all manner of issues related to our community. And we're excited that we're going to have a number of special guests. We're expecting heads of government from the continent and the Caribbean and South America to be coming to the conference. And we'll definitely want to come back and give some more updates as the conference date approaches.
Okay.
I'll be there.
Yeah, please call.
I'm already registered.
You already registered?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Please call back and let us know about that. We can get more people registered. Thank you, President Little, for taking time out of your busy schedule to give us some updates on some things that are going on. Love you, respect you, and anything I can do, you know I'm always here.
I appreciate it. God bless you all.
Okay, cool.
See you.
All right. Wednesday on my other show, I had the pleasure of having former co-host on this show and criminal defense attorney A. Dwight Pettit on. And I want to play a little bit of what he had to say about certain issues that's going on legally. Go ahead, hit it.
Good morning, Carlton. Good morning to your audience. Glad to be with you, my brother.
Oh, man, it's such a pleasure to have you on with us. I'm glad you could find some time out of your busy schedule because we know you're busy.
Oh, yeah. It never stops, and that's a good thing.
Yeah. First of all, how's your lovely wife, Barbara?
She's doing fine. This past week, you mentioned funerals. The good Reverend Vaughn was a good friend of mine. And I understand also Eddie Smith's wife passed, big lawyer in the city. And this past week, we went to the funeral, unfortunately, of Larry Gibson's wife.
Yeah, I heard about that. Yeah, we talked about it. Was mentioned on our show last Friday. I didn't know about Ed Smith's wife.
I think she's the same time as
Larry?
Reverend Vaughn.
Oh, it's Reverend Vaughn? Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Both of them on the first.
Okay.
And that's what we've been doing for the last weekend, and looks like this weekend too, unfortunate as that may be.
Yeah. Please give my condolences to Ed.
It's Diana. Both women were, Larry's wife was Diana Gibson and Eddie's wife, Diana Smith.
Wow. Wow. Please give my condolences to Ed for me, please.
Will do.
Before we get into some legal ramblings, as one of the most notable football players that came out of Howard University, I don't know if you've been following this tweet that Lamar put out yesterday. We're going to cut it there because that's not the part I want you to hear. That was concerning Lamar Jackson. Not ask Dwight, as a football player, a prominent football player for Howard University, about his opinion on that. But the part I want you to hear, and Black's going to try to get to it, is about, and while I said, while he's trying to find, I'm going to get to the two of you. The Court of Appeals, Bob? Oh, Special Court of Appeals decided.
The appellate court.
The appellate court decided that.
The reinstate science.
Reinstate, right. Mm-hmm. What are you guys' opinion on that?
I think they did the right thing. I think the victim's family has the right to be present in the best capacity that they could. I don't think Zoom is enough, especially with the late delay that they received in terms of when they got the message that they will be going to court. Didn't really give them an opportunity to be there and present, even if they wanted to. Now, where that goes in terms of the decision to put them back in jail or let them go free, I don't have enough information on that. But I think based on the victim's rights and the family to be there, for them to review that and allow the family to have, quote unquote, their day in court, that's step one. And I think they should be afforded that opportunity.
I think it was the most asinine decision I've ever heard. The man is not guilty, and that's not going to change whether the victim's family is present or not present. And I think we've done that. That's what part of the issue that I was talking about with Ivan Bates a couple of weeks ago. We've gone too far and to promote the notion that the criminal justice system is supposed to be is a way of vindicating the desire for personal vengeance. It's not. It's not supposed to be that. And this whole right, this whole notion of victims' rights. I mean, this man has been determined on the best scientific evidence to be available to be not have committed the crime. Now we have taken away that man's liberties, or potentially taken away his liberties, and taken it away in the sense that he's now got to go to bed every night wondering if his physical liberties are going to be restrained again, just because somebody couldn't get from L.A. or wherever he was to Baltimore to participate in a proceeding where it ultimately had nothing to do with guilt or innocence of the man in the first place. That is the most ridiculous decision I think I've seen in the 50 years that I've been in this business.
I think Black... got a part that I want y'all to hear. Play it, Black. Let's see what we got. U.S. attorney that's been demoted. Mr.
Wise.
Mr. Wise, yeah. What's your take on this?
Well, I can't really figure it out, Carlton. He's still going to be on the trial team to prosecute Mosby. But it seems as though there has maybe some breakdown between he and the new U.S. attorney. And maybe there's some office dispute in terms of policies. I don't think that it can affect the Mosby trial since he's still on the trial. And maybe he and Mr. Barron didn't see eye to eye on some of the policies, or maybe there's some dispute as to his handling of the Mosby case. We just don't know because it was an inter-office type of action that took place. But the interesting part about it, he's removed from his supervisory role in terms of the fraud unit, but he was not removed from the Mosby trial. And so, you know, he has been very, very, very successful as a trial lawyer for the United States and has this bevy of convictions and political figures that I did not go back into. So obviously he's an excellent attorney. But it's interesting because some of the accusations that the first lawyer for the Mosby made was that he had a racial issue or racial bias. And the court sort of rejected that, and the lawyers got in trouble for raising it. But we don't know whether that was something that might have been simmering around the office that caused Attorney Barron to want to remove him from that unit's leadership.
That was Dwight talking about the situation of Mr. Wise being demoted by the new U.S. attorney, but he's still on the case of Marilyn Mosby. We're going to follow that case. And the big monkey on everybody's back, or more on Donald Trump's back, is that he's been indicted. Now, we do not, and one of the reasons why, of course, we want to get into the major thing about the banking, but next week we're going to get more into that because by next Friday, the indictments should be unsealed. Am I correct, y'all?
Could be by next Friday.
By next Friday. Should I think be. It's supposed to be done Tuesday.
Yes.
And that way we will know exactly what former President Donald Trump is being charged with. Close it out, Tehma.
Thank you for joining us once again on a Friday. I hope you have had a great week, and I hope you have a wonderful weekend. If you need to contact me, I am Tehma Smith-Wilson, an attorney and business owner out of Baltimore City. I can be reached at 667-334-7242, 667-334-7242.
Bob?
This is the first day of the rest of your lives, and because it may be the last, let's make it a good one, and I'll help in any way I can. 410-547-8820. 410-547-8820.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738. That's 410-669-1738. Don't forget, if you don't want to cook on Sunday, United House of Prayer for All People, 3401 Edgewood Road. Also, next Friday is going to be a fish fry down at that same place. Condolences again. The musical and viewing for Reverend A.C. D. Vaughn is today from 5 to 7, I believe, at the Sherman Baptist Church. It's Pressman and Stricker Street. Al, condolences out to Brother Ed Smith, which I didn't know about until I had Dwight on the show the other day. And he and Larry Gibson. And as I always tell you, take your head with your ear. Put it to the ground. Listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be ya. Bye.
Just enough.